I know a lot of you guys, and ladies, but not everybody. And I know that Benny Wozniak had invited people from a broad spectrum of their clients. But I'm wondering, is there anybody here who is not in the oil and gas industry, or anybody who is in renewables or anything? Just trying to judge my audience. Anybody I know? Okay. So that helps me focus my attention. I have been in the oil and gas business for, it's hard to believe, over 40 years. Started when I was 16 in Midland, Texas. But I've also spent most of my career in oil and gas, but I've also worked in renewables, and so I'm not just an oil and gas person. But I'm not here as an advocate for oil and gas or an advocate for and against anything. I'm really here as an advocate for education, and I'm hoping that we can share some information that will help you have a better understanding about some issues that are somewhat related to maybe your job and what you do. So I believe that better education means better knowledge. Better knowledge means better dialogue, better policy, and so on and so forth. So this is really about education. It's not advocacy at all. As you may see from my presentation up here, I've got a little bit different name than you may have seen on the invitation, and I just changed the name a little bit to make it a little more reflective of actually what you're going to learn about today. How renewables, natural gas, electric vehicles, and smart grid are shaping our energy future. And in order to do that, though, everybody wants to hear about renewables and what's going on in the renewable world, and how electricity is interfaced into renewables and electric vehicles and so on and so forth. But unfortunately, before we can get to the good, juicy, romantic stuff, we actually have to have some remedial education on electricity and some of these issues to make them all make sense when we pull it all together at the end. So, I'm not going to do a lot of remedial talking about energy as a whole, because almost everyone here is in the energy business and everyone knows most of this. But I'm going to just show two slides that I normally show to people when I'm trying to educate them more generally about energy. And I love this slide because it shows in perfect form why energy is so important to all of us. This is a curve that shows the relationship between energy use and prosperity. And if anybody remembers statistics from college, you know you have that term, the near-perfect statistical correlation. And the near-perfect statistical correlation here is that how much energy you use is directly correlated to how wealthy you are as a nation. So almost universally, if you use very little energy, your country is almost guaranteed to be very poor. And if you use a lot of energy, you are likely to live in a rich nation, and that is almost, there's almost no exceptions to that rule. Now, in the US and Western Europe, we're doing a much better job the last decade of reducing the amount of energy that's needed in order to have a good lifestyle, but still the correlation holds true. More energy means more prosperity. Less energy means very less prosperity. It means you're probably a poor nation. So, when I also talk about energy to general audiences, I think it's always important to understand global mega trends. And these are just things that we need to keep in the back of our mind that will permeate the rest of the discussion. And when we talk about global megatrends, probably nothing is greater on our mind than population. And so right now we have about a population of about 7.4 billion. And by mid-century, we expect the population of the world to be, I mean, most people are in agreement, somewhere between 2045 and 2050, we're going to have about 9 billion people. Does anybody know the significance of the 9 billion? Why that's an interesting or important number? Come on, I know you probably have. You do, you're just too embarrassed to say. The significance of this is that for the first time, depending on what your belief system is, how many years people have been on the earth, whether it's 5,000 or 100,000 years, during that period of time, during our lifetime, or if we're still alive in 2045, for the first time in the entire history of the world, we will actually not have a growing population. Population is expected to top out at 9 billion and then probably slowly back off, because we have large population trends right now. The growth rate population growth right now has slowed significantly. Even in the United States, we have a negative population growth except for immigration. Europe is the same way. Russia is the same way. In fact, a few years ago, maybe some of you remember this, it's become such a problem in Russia, a negative growth rate, that Russia declared a national holiday to keep people home to procreate. And so obviously we have still strong growth in the third world, but their rate of growth is slowing significantly, and they're coming into the world like we were 100 years ago, smaller families, more industrialization, more urbanization, less need to have large families. And anyway, by most accounts, by 2045, we're going to hit the maximum population growth. Population of that the Earth has ever seen or probably ever will see. So that's a concern for anybody who's talking about natural resources, whether it's energy or water or anything else. The fact that we're going to grow another 1.6 billion is something to be concerned about. But in reality, that's not the big concern. The big concern is world economic parity. Because right now, very few people in the world enjoy the kind of lifestyle that we kind of take for granted. So only about 5% of the world's population enjoys a lifestyle equivalent to the average North American, European, Western European lifestyle. So that means that the rest of the world is hoping and that they will attain our lifestyle as well. And to put this in perspective, we have United States, every one of us in the United States in 2012, which is the most recent year I have complete data from all three countries. The United States, we average, each person in the United States used about the equivalent of 23 barrels of oil apiece. That's not exactly oil, some of it's natural gas, coal, whatever else, but that's the equivalent of 23 barrels of oil. In China, which has been just a booming economy, they use a robust 2.6 barrels per person. And India, which will soon be the largest country in the world in terms of population, uses 1 barrel of oil per person. So let's just think about going from 7.4 to 9.9 billion people is a significant, or not insignificant amount. However, you think about all the people in India, if they were to even explode their use from 1 barrel to 10 barrels, or everyone in China that goes from 2.6 barrels to 15 barrels a day, that has a much more robust effect on world energy than does just the population growth. So, in the next 30 years, billions and billions and billions of people around the world are going to want to aspire to our standard of living. And so, even though we will continue, I'm sure most of us will continue to aspire to even greater standard of living ourselves. I mean, we're all working hard, trying to do good for our family, and maybe buy a bigger house or another car. So while we're still trying to improve ourselves, the rest of the world is trying to catch up with us. And just imagine the pressure on food and water supplies and energy supplies, not because of the population growth, but because of the economic parity that's emerging. And this is as a result of better communication. Everyone in the, 50 years ago, nobody knew how good we had it. If you were living anywhere in the world, you didn't know what was going on in Western Europe and in the United States. But now everyone has access to internet, everyone has cell phones, and so everyone knows, and now they want what we have. So I think in everything else we talked about the rest of the day, this is an important concept to take with us forward. So first thing we're going to do is talk a little bit about electricity. And I would imagine that almost everybody here takes electricity for granted. Nobody gets up in the morning, jumps out of bed, and goes to the light switch and says, oh my gosh, thank you for being here, and think about all the things that go into delivering that electricity. But of course, we use electricity for everything. The alarm clock, the refrigerator, the hot water heater, the stove, the toaster oven, the curling iron, charging our iPhones, everything we have in here today, the projector, the lights, the food was prepared with the use of electricity. It is astonishing how much we use electricity, and probably most of us don't really think about it, even though we as energy professionals probably think about it more than even the average person. Electricity is a fairly new invention, although some might say that electricity has been used for over 2,000 years. Supposedly in Greece, in about the year 600, there's documentation that the Greeks would use amber and rub it and create static electricity and use it to clean their clothes. So that would be the first application of electricity in some form. But really, electricity as we know it today really didn't kind of get started until Thomas Edison in 1880s, when he started making electricity household functional. I mean, I have on this slide here, of course, Ben Franklin. We think about him doing experiments with electricity in 1750. But Thomas Edison started the one of the first electric generating plants in New York in 1882. And so that really ushered in the age of electricity. By 1932, which is kind of, or 1930 or 32, at the beginning of the Great Depression, there was only about 10% of the homes in the United States that had electricity. Amazingly how fast it grew. By 1945, the end of the Second World War, just 15 years later, we had blossomed almost 50% of the homes. Lyndon Johnson is on this, even though he was quite an SOB. One of the great things he did for the country and for Texas was he was a great advocate for electrification, especially in small rural areas that really didn't have access to electricity. And this, he understood how important electricity was for prosperity, because without electricity, you don't have lights, you can't study at night, you can't have effective schools, and so on and so forth. So LBJ should be credited as being one of the great advocates for rural electrification. And of course, today, in the United States, we have 99.9% of the United States has electricity. There are obviously some hovel somewhere in West Virginia or someplace, there are a few people that don't. But for all practical purposes, we're fully electrified here in the U.S. But there's probably about 1.2 to 1.5 billion people worldwide that have no access to electricity at all right now. So the last thing I want to impart, which is really important going forward, understanding how we use electricity and how renewables interface with that and natural gas, is the structure in which electricity is delivered to our house. Now, it's different in every state. I'm just going to talk in generalities. But generally, when electricity started to be delivered, they realized they couldn't have a bunch of different electric lines coming into your house from different companies. So if you go to fill up your car today, you can make a decision about where you fill up your car, and you might want to go the cheapest place, or you might go the most convenient place by your house, or you might go to a certain place and buy your gasoline because you like clean bathrooms, whatever it is, but you can make a choice. But if you have electricity brought into your house, you really don't have those kind of choices, because early on when they started designing towns for electricity, the local governments would issue a monopoly, a license to a company to work in that neighborhood, and they became a monopoly. And they were the only ones who could deliver electricity to that house. Now, it's a little bit different now, but that's generally speaking, that's still where we are in the U.S. I don't know, does anybody here have more than one electric line in their house? Okay, so you have one electric line in your house. Now, what is the natural problem with a monopoly? Pricing, lack of competition, accountability, so on and so forth. So at the same time that they awarded these utilities a license to operate, they also put them under the jurisdiction of a utility commission. And every state has their own, and the structure is different in every state. But we're just going to talk in generalities. So generally, a state will regulate the electricity use, and they will make sure that this monopoly power is not abused. And so they will have some regulatory oversight on prices, and they'll have regulatory oversight on safety and regulatory oversight on a whole vast variety of issues to make sure that these monopolies are operated safely and efficiently and cost effectively. So historically, utility commissions, the most important thing, and that's been from the very beginning until now, and I'm gonna drill these in because these are gonna be important concepts later, safety and reliability is more important. It doesn't matter what the price is, it doesn't matter how environmentally good or bad or benign or whatever it is, it doesn't matter about any of those things unless it's safe and reliable. So electricity, almost every utility commission in the country, whether it's local, statewide, whether it's in the east or the west, north or the south, safety and reliability are paramount. They have to be observed. So the commissions are going to make sure as their oversight of these utilities, that is going to be their number one priority. In the past, electrification of American homes was a very important priority, although that's not a priority anymore. And then cost of service was a third thing. You want it safe, you want it reliable, and you also want it cheap. Now, you didn't sacrifice safety and reliability for cost, but you always wanted low cost because that was what the consumer wanted. They wanted low cost electricity, safe and reliable. Let's talk about how prices are sort of determined in that scenario. And I'm going to talk about it and not have you read about it. Let's just talk about how the prices for, let's say we're in Colorado and we've got Xcel Energy here and they want to decide how much can they charge. Now, if they weren't regulated, there'd be no limit to what they could charge because they know that you don't have an alternative. If you decide the rates get too high, you can't just switch over to another electric company because they're the only one that's delivering to you. So what happens is the utility commission, Public Utility Commission, makes the utilities come in every year, and basically what they do is they say, I'm Xcel. We have this many customers this year, and we expect this many people to move into Colorado, and we have this many power plants, and we need to build this many new power plants, and we need to do maintenance and upgrades on these, so we're going to have this X number of dollars of cost this year. And then the utility commission will say, well, I think if you do your job correctly, you should get a 6% rate of return. So basically say, we're going to grant you a 6% rate of return on your business, provided you do everything the way you're supposed to. And consequently, you're going to get a 6% rate of return, you know what the costs are, then they can determine what the rate is going to be for that year. So they're going to charge you 10 cents a kilowatt hour, 11 cents, whatever it is. So basically, we pay as customers whatever the actual costs are. I mean, but effectively the idea is that the companies are somewhat without risk, because as long as they do what they're told, what they've said they're going to do, they're going to have a guaranteed rate of return. We, as the customers, bear the cost of new plants and upgrades and so on and so forth. So that's a very important concept. So that basically says what I just said, but I wanted to say it without you having to read it. Let's talk about electric load analysis. We're still in the remedial part of this presentation about learning about electricity. Base load we refer to as the primary load that's running all the time. So at 3 o'clock in the morning, when everyone's asleep and nobody's on their computer and there's no computers on or anything like that, I mean, I'm not speaking literally, but you know, for the most part, everyone's in bed, there's not a lot of electricity being used, there's always a background amount of electricity that's being used. You've got your refrigerator that's always running, your heater or air conditioner at your house, and so on and so forth. There's always things that are running. So the base load is kind of that base amount that's always there. And then ramping up load, as in the morning when we wake up and start using our hair dryer and our air conditioners, our computers, then we have to start adding capacity to the grid in order to meet the demand. And then peak load is electric plants that provide peak power but are on standby most of the time. They are there only to provide power at 2 o'clock in the afternoon for a few minutes when, you know, air conditioning load's high in August. So, and once all plants are running, the additional capacity must be supplied from maybe buying electricity from another state or something like that. So let's look at this more in a more friendly depiction. Here we have a graph that shows in the morning or all day long we have base load that's running, coal, natural gas, it could be a lot of different things. And at 6 in the morning the load is pretty low and we're just barely coming up above base load as people start waking up and turning on their appliances. And as we go on, so this is what we call the ramp-up demand. So we have a plant here, and we're just going to, just for the sake of discussion today, we're going to say that this is a coal plant, and this plant makes 1 gigawatt of power, and it costs $1 billion. Just so you have it in your mind. $1 billion to build this, so we paid $1 billion to build a plant that operates 24 hours a day, providing electricity 24 hours a day, base load. Then at 6 in the morning, as the appliances start coming on, we don't have enough electricity from this plant, so we have another plant that comes on. And it starts slowly and then builds up and gets to a maximum capacity. And then there's not enough energy from that plant to meet the demand, so we go to a third plant. Now, some of this energy may be being supplied by wind turbines and sun solar panels, but we still have these plants backing it up because we don't know always when the wind's going to be blowing or when the sun's going to be shining. And so this plant, how much do you think this plant costs?
$1 billion.
It makes the same amount. So then later in the afternoon, we pulled on three plants, each cost $1 billion. And then when we get to 2 o'clock in the afternoon for just a few minutes, we need some peak power for all of our air conditioners in Colorado. And this plant comes on, but is only on for 15 minutes or 30 minutes that day. How much does this plant cost?
$1 billion.
Okay, so $1 billion for this plant that runs 24 hours a day. And then $1 billion for this plant that runs 12 minutes. So what can we infer from this analysis about the cost of peak power?
Expensive.
Very expensive, much more expensive than baseline, basically power. And on a national average, I saw last year there was an article that said on average, the peak plants across the US on average, these peaking plants on average work about 12 days a year. I also saw an article in New York paper that said that all of the peaking plants in the state of New York last year worked on average 40 hours for the whole year. So that's $1 billion divided by 40 hours as opposed to $1 billion divided by 365 days. So the concept is peak power is very expensive. But do we really need this right here? Do we need the top one? Well, up until now, the answer has been yes, because we don't only want electricity when it's available. We're not a third world country where the lights come on and go off and we don't know when they're coming on or off. We expect our electricity on demand. Businesses expect electricity when they want it, not when we want to give it to them. And basically, the utilities have mandated that your electricity has to be safe and what else?
Reliable.
So we build these billion-dollar plants for that aren't used very often. So the traditional customer relationship is all costs of capital and fuel and expenses are passed on to the customer. We talked about that. Utilities are granted a rate which will allow them to recover their costs plus a reasonable rate of return. Historically, electric utilities can only increase their profits by selling more electricity. So they get to the beginning of the year and they say, we have this many customers, we're gonna sell this much electricity, this is gonna be our rate of return. Now you've got executives at Xcel who are saying, my bonus is tied to better performance. If I make a little bit more money this year, I get a bigger bonus. So the only way that they can get a better bonus is if they actually sell more electricity than they told the commission they were gonna do the year before. And this is illustrated in the past. I mean, some of you may remember, but for a long time, utilities had all sorts of programs that they would try and encourage you to use electricity. I remember in Oklahoma, the utility would always give away as many little strands of Christmas lights as you wanted. You basically just went down to OG&E at Christmas, and you could take as many boxes as you wanted because they knew they were going to make their money off of selling you the electricity. Now, of course, that's not really consistent with where we are today environmentally. And having a fixed price for electricity, which we've talked about, basically the fixed price that we talked about, that they decide, talk to the utility, they tell how much the utilities tell the commission how much money they're going to spend this year, and the commission says, all right, we're going to let you charge 11 cents a kilowatt hour in order to recover your costs and make a fair profit. And so that is a fixed cost. But the problem is that fixed cost doesn't encourage anyone to save electricity during peak hours. I mean, if your electricity is 11 cents a kilowatt hour at 4 in the afternoon when it's really hot, you're probably not really incentivized to cut back your electricity. However, if prices were real tight, because we know peak power, the peak power that they're delivering to you on that afternoon is much more than what you're being charged for it. It all gets rolled in. But basically, if because it's a fixed price, there's no incentive for us to save electricity because of the pricing structure that we're used to. So the peak power dilemma, we've already talked about this, cost of capital, our fuel and expenses are passed on to the customer, and we ultimately pay for these peak power plants, you and me. This isn't the power, this is an Xcel. They don't have any costs that aren't passed on. So basically, they build these plants, they justify them, and then whatever they cost gets rolled into your bill. And then the cost of peak electricity is much higher, and the fixed price doesn't induce consumers to lower demand, and the cost of electricity is shared by all of us. So those are all the concepts I just told you. So historically, we talked earlier about the important, what the utilities commissions were, what was important to them in terms of how they were managing electric utilities. The utility commission said, we want it safe and reliable. That's not negotiable. Electrify all the homes, we've done that. And cost of service was important to keep costs as low as possible. Today, safety and reliability is still the highest priority. However, we have two now competing cost of service and environmentally benign that are butting heads all the time. So what happens is at the rate hearing this year, you're going to have some people come into the commission and say, it's very, very important that we keep the cost low. We've got poor people who can't afford electricity. This is hurting our economy. We got businesses that are leaving because of our high electricity prices. So we got people banging the table, telling the commission, we have to keep prices low. Prices low usually means coal or something like that. And then we have other people, Sierra Club shows up at the same meeting and they're banging their fist and saying, we're ruining the world. We can't afford to have these low prices because it's hurting the environment. We need renewable energy, and that's fine, but the cost means there's a trade-off. There's always a trade-off, and if you and the commissions are sitting here every year trying to figure out and balance all of these needs. Do you think it's possible to have safe, reliable, inexpensive, and environmentally friendly electricity? And I'm not expecting you to answer that, but that's the question that the commission is faced with every day. That's all a trade-off. So in the future, I think we're moving towards safety and reliability will always be the most important, but moving forward, real-time pricing is going to become a priority for utilities, promoting conservation and being environmentally benign. And we see this happening already here in Colorado. In fact, I believe Xcel Energy is paid a bonus if they can reduce electric use. You know, in the past, they're handing out Christmas lights to increase their usage. Now they're not rewarded for that kind of behavior. Now they basically say, okay, your per customer usage this last year was X amount. If you can reduce it by 5% on average across your client base, maybe we'll give you a 1% rebate. We'll help you share in those savings. So now you get letters in the mail from Xcel saying, are you sure you want a plasma TV? We noticed that your electric bill is higher than your neighbors. Are you sure you don't want to think about? So they're doing what they can to reduce electric use, both as a good service for the customers, but also it helps them. They have a self-interest in having you reduce your electric use. So any questions so far? So we know about the utility commissions. We know what's driving these utility commissions and the policies. So let's just talk very briefly about how electricity is created, just so that it makes sense for everybody when we go forward with the rest of the discussion. In most cases, whether it's a coal plant or a gas-fired plant or whatever other kind of plant, most times what you have is a turbine, whichever you pronounce it, that is spinning. And as that turbine spins, it throws off electrons, which are captured by usually a copper wire, and that's where electricity is. So in order to get electricity, you need to spin something really fast to spin off those electrons onto the copper wire. So what we often do is we create heat, and then as we heat water, as water rises, steam is a very powerful transporter of energy, and you heat the water, the steam rises, and as the steam rises, it passes through the turbine. The turbine then spins, and as a result, it spins the generator, and the electricity is thrown off. So this is the same, whether this is coal in here, this could be nuclear energy creating that, it could be natural gas, it could be one of many things. The same basic concept with hydro is it's just we've stored water up here, and when we're ready for electricity, we let the water fall down, and as it creates speed, as it goes down, the turbine's down here, and as the water goes past the turbine, it spins. Same concept, just cold water instead of hot. And of course, this is the most simplest form of a turbine. It basically takes the wind and automatically converts it to energy right there on the spot. So how do we currently generate electricity in the US? These are probably the most recent, the most up-to-date statistics. I'm not sure, I haven't seen the final 14 statistics, although they may be out. But this tells you pretty closely, you know, as a nation, we use still over a third of our, nearly 40% is coal, and natural gas has increased significantly the last decade. How do you think we compare in Colorado? Because we are a really clean state here. We really care about the environment. How do you think our numbers in Colorado compare to the national level? Venture a guess, somebody.
Same.
Same? You don't think we're better?
I think we use more coal.
Aha! A reward for that. And I double checked these figures last night to make sure that no smarty pants would call me out on it, but this is right. In Colorado, even though we've done a lot of coal switching in the last 5 years, and although we are really putting a focus on wind power and natural gas, we still use 2/3 of our electricity statewide is generated by coal. So, all right, did anybody take a look at this? As you're sitting and eating, did anybody actually fill out? It says, guess how much energy we will be using. Now this is a chart that shows all types of energy. This is not just electricity, but this is all types of energy that we use in the United States. So in 2012, 27% of all the energy used was natural gas, 37% was petroleum, coal was 18%. And the question is, where do you think we're going to be in 25 years? I mean, we are pushing renewables, we are pushing the limit, we got tax credits, we're going. Where are we going to be? So, you think, what do you think renewables will be? You think it'll, it's, so right now we're at 8% plus biofuels is one, so right now we're at 9% renewables. Who thinks we'll be at 50% renewables? 30? 20? 20. Okay, now I'm going to show you what the EIA just came out with as far as what they say it's going to be. Now I'm not saying that's what it's going to be, but this is also not some chump up here who's just making this up as he goes. I'm just telling you the Energy Information Administration, a reputable, often regarded as one of the best federal agencies that we have, this is what they think we're going to be in 25 years. Renewables is going to go up. 2% here and 1% down here, so it's going to go up a total of 3%. Now, personally, and like I said, I'm not here to advocate for or against anything. Personally, I think we're going to do much better than that. But even if we double, even if we go from 12% or 9% or 10% to 20%, that still means we got 80% that's not renewable. So I think this is really startling, especially for people who are real. That's why I ask if there's any renewable people here. I'm not here to insult anybody or, you know, advocate for or against renewables, but it's really stark to realize that we're really going to be dependent on petroleum and coal and natural gas, even, you know, throughout our lifetime. Now, I saw Betsy Ford in an article today about the coming revolution of electric cars. And just so happened, I already read that article, and I did. I see that, you know, supposedly this is really going to reduce our demand for petroleum. But where are we going to get electricity? Yeah. From coal? probably a lot of it will come from natural gas. So I'm not sure we're really going to reduce our, even with electric cars, that we're going to reduce significantly the amount of fossil fuels that we're using. I'm not an advocate, I'm just bringing you the facts. And these, I think we'll do better than this, but that's pretty stark. One of the last concepts I want to talk about before we move on to talking about the specific renewables is the concept of grid management, because electricity, unlike most other primary fuels, cannot be stored very effectively. So if you've got gasoline and you've got a big glut of gasoline, well, you can just store it in a tank. If you've got natural gas, you can store it in the ground, you can pack it into pipelines. Right now, we're storing a lot of excess crude oil in tankers offshore. I mean, we're putting it where we can find it, but we can store all these other forms of energy. Electricity cannot really be stored very effectively. We're working, that's why battery technology, you hear so much about that, that is a huge deal, because if we can ever find a way to effectively, cost-effectively store electricity, then that opens up a whole new avenue for other ways to manage our energy. But right now we don't, I mean, we don't have a building in downtown, you know, a huge big building that's just a big battery that can operate Denver at night when the sun's not shining and the wind's not blowing. So we don't have that ability right now. So what happens is down here at the XL building, up on 17th floor or something, they have a control center where they've got computers around the room and they've got people sitting there 24/7, even Christmas and Thanksgiving. And they have this amazing task. They are trying to make sure that demand and supply is exactly paired up at every moment and every hour and every second of every day. Because if you have more electricity in the system than you need, then you're going to blow out a transformer. And if you don't have enough electricity to meet the needs at that very moment, you're going to have a brownout or a blackout and you're not going to have electricity. So these guys are heroes because they have to try and figure out how much electricity we're going to need. They're trying to anticipate how many people are turning on their hair dryers. They also have, so on the supply, on the demand side, they got to figure out who's using what when. And they've got all these, you know, great models, and they look statistically in the past, and they know generally when people turn their hair dryers on in the morning. But they have to manage that minute by minute. But now it's even much more complicated, because in the past, what they would do as demand would go up or demand would go down, they just turn the knob, coal goes down, coal goes up, natural gas goes down, natural gas goes up. It was easy, not easy, but relatively easy, because you only worried about the demand side. But now, a lot of your electricity is coming from renewables like wind and solar, which offer another layer of variability on the other side. So they're trying to figure out what you're going to use, and at the same time, they're trying to figure out on the other side of the room, when's wind coming on? What's the forecast? When are the windmills going to stop going? When's the sun going behind a cloud? All that sort of stuff. So it's an amazing feat. But basically what this illustrates is you got coal going all the time, hydro going all the time, the wind's going up and down, the solar's coming on and going off, coming on, going off. And somewhere in between, we have to actually perfectly match our supply with what our demand, and the demand is red. And so somewhere in between here, I'm calling the gray natural gas. It could be something else. It could be coal or geothermal. But basically, you have to have some energy here that can fill in the gaps as it's going up and down. And it's a pretty amazing when you think about what they're doing to make sure the lights are on every day. So we can't store electricity, and utilities are constantly adjusting and balancing. The last concept that I want to talk about before we move on to specifically looking at the individual types of renewables is the concept of capacity factor. So I just put a definition that somebody else made up, this isn't mine, but it's the ratio of actual energy produced by an energy generating unit, whatever it is, coal or natural gas or whatever, or system in a given period to the hypothetical possible maximum. So let's put that in English. You have a coal plant that we talked about cost of $1 billion and it makes 1 gigawatt of energy. So if the coal plant is supposed to make 1 gigawatt and the coal plant has to go down twice a year for 3 days for basic maintenance, and then there's a lightning strike sometime in the spring and it goes down for a day unexpectedly. Basically that coal plant is working 95% of the time. Maybe even more, but 95% of the time is probably a good round figure. So the capacity factor for that coal plant is 95%. It's working on average during a year, it's on 95% of the time. You could say the same thing about a natural gas plant, 95% capacity factor. You could say the same thing about a hydroelectric plant, because it probably, unless there's a drought like there is in California now, unless you don't have water in the lake, you can operate that pretty much whenever you want, unless there's basic maintenance. This is a big deal though, because when we talk about capacity factors, people who talk about renewables and how viable they are often talk about what a plant is capable of doing and fail to talk about the capacity factor. So for instance, anybody venture a guess what the average capacity factor for a wind farm is in the United States? If you took all the wind farms the whole United States, how much percentage of the time do you think they're operating? 28, 30, anybody else? 15. In 2014, the average capacity factor nationwide was 34%. So, let's assume for the moment that you can build a wind farm that makes 1 gigawatt for the same price that you can build a coal plant or a natural gas plant. So 1 gigawatt of coal plant costs $1 billion, a 1 gigawatt natural gas plant costs $1 billion, and a 1 gigawatt wind farm makes the same amount, costs the same amount, makes the same amount. Now that's probably not true. I'm not sure wind is quite there, but it's close. But let's just assume that they all can be built for the same cost. And then the wind advocates will often say, look, we can build a wind farm for the same price that you can build a coal plant. Why do we need a coal plant anymore when we can build a wind farm? And what is the answer? It only works 34% of the time. Which means in order to have it, what's the most important thing that the utilities require? Safety and reliability. So you can't just operate when the wind blows. So in fact, if you do the math, if you go through the complicated math of saying 34%, then if you build a second wind farm, how much, I mean, some people would say, well, you just build 3 wind farms and then that covers you. But that's not even true either, because you're assuming that when this wind farm goes off, this one magically comes on, the wind's here, and then when this one goes off, this one comes on. So in reality, if you do the math, it takes about 7 wind farms to create 99% reliability that a coal plant or a natural gas plant covers. So even though they cost the same, it doesn't take into account the capacity factor. So this is kind of a depiction of what I just said. We've got coal plant, natural gas, wind, and solar. They all make 1 gigawatt. They all cost $1 billion. The problem is, and so if this is true, then theoretically the cost of all of these is the same. But as we know, in order to make reliability, we'd have to have 7 wind farms all producing at some group effort to make reliability. But that's not functional either, because now this costs 7 times as much to build 7 wind farms, so you can't do that. So what do we do instead? Since we can't build 7 wind farms, what do we do instead? We build a power plant as a backup. So when you talk about the cost of wind, the cost of this wind farm is not the $1 billion. The cost is the $1 billion plus the cost of whatever backup you have to build to back it up. And the same for solar. So be careful when you listen to people talk about wind and solar being the same cost. It's the same cost to construct the actual plant. It's not the same cost to operate. It's a little different. I said I didn't have any more basic concepts, so I got one more. Who here has heard of rare earth minerals? Almost everybody. Be honest, 5 years ago, how many people had heard of rare earth minerals? Very few of us. It's a buzzword because it's really come to the forefront of conversation. We're not going to talk about the specifics of rare earth minerals, other than these rare earth minerals are generally needed to make a lot of the components necessary for renewables. Batteries for batteries, magnets for wind turbines, car motors, fuel cells, so on and so forth. All of these minerals are needed. And they're called rare earth minerals principally because they're rare, and they're earth minerals, and we don't find them in great abundance. And for many years, China was the largest producer of rare earth minerals. And for many years, China exported their rare earth minerals to Western Europe and the United States so that we could make wind turbines and solar cells and fuel cells. And a few years ago, probably about 5 years ago when we first started hearing about this, China decided, why are we exporting all this stuff? Because if they don't have these minerals, then they can't make these things anymore, and then we can make them here. And that's why China's production of wind turbines and solar panels has exploded, because they almost have the world market cornered on rare earth minerals. As you can see, the US in blue, that's how many we make. And in 2010, you can see just in the corner, we just mined a few rare earth minerals. So with that in mind, I think that's our final concept. We can get to the romantic, juicy part in understanding how these renewables are used and relate to energy production and electricity. And we'll talk about electric vehicles too. So, wind farm. What's good about a wind farm? What do you think is good about a wind farm?
Wind is free.
Wind is free, okay. What about the cost of building the wind farm? Not free. Wind is generally perceived to be very beneficial, very clean, and in reality, it is one of the cleaner resources. A lot of times when we talk about wind, though, we don't think about the environmental effects of mining, the products that are necessary in order to build the wind turbines and the solar cells. It doesn't take into account the fact that most of these are made overseas, and they have to be transported from China to the U.S., and then they have to be transported from Houston to Wyoming. And so even though wind, as a general rule, is probably the most easy and, from a business standpoint, the easiest thing right now to do, the most cost-effective, there are some other drawbacks. Of course, there's high capital costs. Does anybody think that wind turbines are an eyesore? Okay, some people do. It's all in the eyes of the beholder, so there's nothing magical about this. This, in fact, was a wind farm that I worked on in Oklahoma. It was the first wind farm ever built in Oklahoma, so I found a picture of it on the internet. We built this, the company I worked for built this down in the Arbuckle Mountains just outside of Lawton. One of the other big concerns right now, before I get to the environmental concerns, we obviously already talked about this, but I used to say that it was unreliable, and my friends in the renewable industry didn't like me calling the wind unreliable, so now I call it intermittent. But we've already talked about it's only 34% usage, so it has to have another source of energy as a backup. But then there are some other things that you might not think about. Anybody heard about the wind farm out in California that's scheduled to shut down because it's killed so many birds? I'm not sure that you can ever place one of these someplace where it can't do any harm, but certainly where you place these can make a difference, and putting them in the path of migratory birds is not good. So when we always say we got all these places we can put wind farms, that's not always exactly true, because some places are better than others. The big thing, and then of course all of these require rare earth minerals, so that's another drawback. And again, I'm not here to advocate against wind, I'm just pointing out that there are some problems. And then another issue with wind is it doesn't always occur when you need it the most. So you'll see here the difference between the load, which is shown in red, the electric load, and I got this from NREL, and the wind. And wind, normally, it blows the most at night and early morning when the loads are the least, and it blows the least during the day when the loads are the most. So that's another drawback. But one of the worst, let me focus on this real quick. This is another thing I got from a friend at Public Service of Colorado. So this is an actual graph showing. So this isn't just made up something that I'm talking about abstractly. This blue line is the wind line, and you can see how it goes up and goes down. And so when that happens, something else is having to come on or go off. Now, that leads us to one of the big issues with wind, which we are dealing with. But has anybody heard of coal cycling? Besides Jim, I know Jim knows about coal cycling. Wind constantly fluctuates. And so as the wind goes off, we know we have to be reliable. We know we can't store the energy. So as the wind goes off, something comes on. So 5 or 6 years ago, well, in Colorado, how much of our electricity is generated by coal? 2/3. Yeah. So what do you think is coming on when the wind is going off? Coal. Now, less now than 5 years ago, but coal comes on. Now, here's the problem. Coal is kind of like diesel fuel in a truck running down the highway. If you've got a big diesel truck running down the highway at 70 miles an hour towards Garden City, Kansas, it's just running efficiently as anything. Then it comes into town, and it's in stop-and-go traffic, and all of a sudden, every time it's stopping and going, it's spewing out large amounts of pollution. Coal plants work the same way. They, even though you may call them dirty, but they operate a lot cleaner when they operate in a steady operating environment. So when the coal is produced and is going all day long, then it operates relatively cleanly. But then we start introducing wind into the equation, and the wind contracts are basically take or pay contracts. So the wind has to be taken, and if you decide, the utility decides not to take it, they still have to pay for it. So these are take or pay contracts. So the utility takes the wind whenever the wind comes on, which means something else gets bumped off, but because of reliability, the minute the wind goes off, we instantaneously have to turn something back on. So a few years ago, a company, there's a lot of people here in the Denver area who were noticing that the air quality appeared to be getting worse with, rather than better with the wind. And there was a speculation that the more wind farms that were being put on, the more volatility in the electric load that was caused by the wind was causing the actual air quality to get worse. Because whatever was saved, whatever was improved by having wind energy was more than offset by the coal coming on and off and on and off and on and off. Now, in fairness to our friends at Xcel, they have done a lot of work to try and mitigate this problem, and they're going more and more towards using gas as their fuel of choice when they can. But again, this is just another issue that most people don't think about when they think about wind. Hoover Dam. What's good about, why don't we use more hydroelectricity? It seems pretty good. It's clean.
Destroys our fisheries.
Uh-huh. So it's not all perfect. It is clean. Another thing that's good about it is it's on demand. So unlike some other energies, which take time to ramp up, coal can take time to ramp up. Another problem with coal, going back to coal, is if you turn it on and off, you don't really ever turn coal completely off. You just turn it down. You have to leave it still running. So even if you got wind going, the coal plant's still running at a lower speed, waiting for the wind to go off. So that's another problem with that. but anyway, back to hydroelectricity. It's also, so on demand is really good. It's fairly cheap over the life cycle. I mean, this dam costs a lot of money, but it's there for 100 years. So over a lifetime, it's fairly inexpensive. It also has a high capacity factor, which means if it's capable of making a gigawatt, it's probably going to make a gigawatt, not a half a gigawatt or a quarter. It's going to make close to the gigawatt. So what are the problems? Okay, it destroys fisheries. Takes a long time to develop, but there are lots of emerging social and environmental concerns which basically make it impractical to think that this will be a renewable energy source in the United States. This is not going to be the savior. There's not that many great locations available in the United States. A lot of the best locations have already been used, but the environmental groups have really focused in on hydropower. In fact, there's more capacity in the next 5 years, probably going to be more capacity decommissioned than there is added. So it's not going to even stay where it is now. Up in the Pacific Northwest, there's a lot of pressure on those dams on the Columbia River Basin and that area. So just to give you an idea why we can't expect that this is going to be the savior of us, is look at, this is a worldwide map of dam building activity, both dams under construction and dams planned. And you can see a notable lack of damming in the United States. So there's not going to be much hydroelectricity. We can't look to that to be a meaningful part of the solution. Okay, geothermal. So here's the same thing we talked about earlier. But instead of using coal or nuclear to generate the heat, we just take hot water out of the ground, drill a well down in a very hot area, and it comes up and spins the turbine and creates electricity. So it's the same concept, just using natural heat rather than creating the heat with a third source. So what's good about hydroelectricity? Oh, I'm trying to engage you.
Great
for baseload. It's clean. It's relatively inexpensive if you can find somebody who knows where to drill it and not drill a bunch of wells that, you know, aren't productive. If you've got a good geologist and you are familiar with the area and you can drill a well, then it depends how hot it is. I mean, it's all about the temperature change. If you can find a place that's really hot and a lot of hot water, then it's very economic. It also has a high capacity factor. So just like natural gas, this geothermal plant probably operates 90, 95% capacity all the time. So what are the problems with geothermal? Pardon me?
You have to drill really deep next to faults.
That's one problem. One of the big, just as a general sense, the big problem is most of the geothermal sites in the United States are on federal lands. Who likes to deal with federal lands? The blue numbers on this map show the percentage of federal lands in each state. Colorado, over a third of the total acreage in this state is federal. Look at poor Nevada, 85%. Utah, almost 60%. And so the federal government is just as hard to work with getting geothermal leases as it is oil and gas leases. And so since most of the areas where we have geothermal activity are in the West, and most of those areas are on federal lands, you know, it is a good resource, and I'm not saying that we won't have more geothermal developed, and I'm not saying we probably should have more developed, but it is not going to be some sort of silver bullet that's going to save us from ourselves, because there's just not enough lands and not enough good sources, places for drilling geothermal wells. Let me tell you, though, where geothermal is exploding right now, and you may not know this, but it's a hot item for homes. And actually, the Denver area is one of the hot spots in the country. And so I should put a picture here, small-scale geothermal. But you well know about IKEA. IKEA became the first commercial building in the United States. The IKEA here became the first building in the United States that was completely heated and cooled from geothermal energy. And what they did is they basically drilled all these geothermal wells to tap in before they laid the foundation, had all these pipes coming up, and then they laid the foundation. All the heat that comes from the earth to use for heat pumps and to heat and cool that building, they do 100%. So IKEA was the first, and I believe IKEA has built the second one in Kansas City. And so this is a prototype for business, but a lot of homeowners, it doesn't work for small scale homes, but if you got a home over $400,000 probably, if you're building a brand new home, you ought to look into geothermal. Because there's a lot of geothermal resources in the Denver area, and you can, it's takes a long payout, but you know, it doesn't, there's not a lot of moving parts, and so over the long run, there can be a lot of benefits. So I actually see maybe small scale geothermal for businesses and homes being more viable than a large scale geothermal for electric generation. So, solar cells. What kind of solar cells are these?
Photovoltaic.
Yeah, that's right. PV. So basically, this is you've got a membrane here, absorbs the light, and because of the technology, it instantly converts the light into electric energy using some of these rare earth minerals. So the good about this is obvious. It's clean, and obviously it's usable any place where there's sun, and there's almost a limitless amount of energy from the sun. So what's bad about? Well, before I do that, there's one other good thing about PV that I think is overlooked a lot, and that is it can be used distributively. Does anybody know what that means? So right now, our whole electric grid is predicated on big power plants in Pueblo and up north and, you know, around, and they supply electricity, which has to go through transmission lines and has to be distributed out to homes. And so one of the good things about solar, one of the best things about solar, is it can be used distributively. You can put it on your house, you can put it on the building across the street, you can put it on the power, on the street signs or the lights where you need out in the country where you don't have electricity. So that's a good thing about it. So costs have fallen dramatically. I mean, just 5 years ago, the cost of solar power from PV was 3, 4, 5 times the cost of coal and natural gas generated electricity. But now the cost of these solar panels has come down so much that it is, on a large scale, can be competitive with natural gas and coal. So what's the problem with PV still?
Eyesore.
Pardon me?
Eyesore.
Eyesore, that's a good one. Anybody heard of intermittent? So what do you think the average capacity factor is for a solar plant? We know what it is for wind, 34%. Average for solar plant. It's highly variable, depends on where it is. So obviously Arizona is different than Massachusetts, but it ranges in the US from 5 to 25%, meaning the best sites are only 25%. Because when they rate the capacity of that panel is, it makes a gigawatt if it is exactly positioned in the perfect position for the sun. The sun is out, there's no cloud, there's no dust, but that only happens for a moment during the day, because even on the day, first of all, we know there's gonna be days when there's clouds. We know where there's days when it's gonna be raining, they're not gonna get any sun or very little. But say that on a sunny day, it's only operating at max capacity for that moment in which it is actually facing the sun at the perfect angle. So unless you've got a motor that follows the sun, it's already losing capacity factor every minute of the day, except that moment that the sun's at the perfect spot. You have dust, you have bird droppings, you have all sorts of things that mitigate the effectiveness of these solar panels. So even in the best, even in the Southwest, out in the desert, 25% is the average capacity factor for solar. That's pretty bad. I shouldn't say bad. It's pretty stunning. So you can't really rely on it for reliability's sake. Another thing that has to be said about, obviously we've got rare earth minerals that are very significant, and so the fact that rare earth minerals are needed, that's another thing that makes it not very desirable. And then I guess the biggest thing of all is it really can't be stored. So it only is effective during the day when you need it. So if you have sun, you know, in the you don't have sun in the afternoon and in the evening, and you can't store excess electricity for use at night, then this is really only useful a few hours a day. For me, one of the big problems, other big problems with this, and I'm not trying to bash PV, but the reality must be known, that the manufacturing process of this is being revealed to be very dirty and very, China is basically being made into a toxic wasteland in areas where they're either manufacturing this or whether they're mining the minerals needed to make these. So that's a big issue. And you know, it's not good enough to say we're clean here. I mean, California has done this for a long time. They say we're really clean. Well, what they really mean is they just build their power plants in Nevada. And then they say, well, we don't have any air quality problems here. They basically ship their dirtiness somewhere else. Well, these solar panels are much akin the same way. You're basically shipping the dirtiness to, you're saying we're clean here, but you're creating dirty, toxic wastelands in China as a result of you wanting to be able to look at yourself in the mirror and say, I'm clean here. So the other big problem with solar panels is we really haven't determined how we're going to dispose of all these. We're building all these, but it's gonna be kind of like a nuclear waste, and 20 years from now, we're gonna have millions of these, and we really don't have a plan right now in place for what we're gonna do, because they won't be don't work forever. So another 15 years as we start replacing them, we're gonna have to deal with that. Okay, so there's a different kind of solar. How are we doing? A different kind of solar. Let me back up. Anybody who's interested in reading about, specifically about the manufacturing process of solar panels, I recommend this book. It talks about all sorts of solar energy, but the reason I recommend this book, if you're interested, is because it's written by a guy who has spent a lifetime as a renewable energy card-carrying environmentalist. He is a professor at Cal Berkeley, I believe, and he's written this book, and he kind of draws back the curtain on some of these issues, and particularly the manufacturing process of the solar cells. And if you really want to learn more, this is a great book to read, because it's pretty eye-opening to see what kind of devastation we're reaping over there on China. Okay, this is the other kind of solar. What kind of solar is this? What is it?
Array.
Solar array. We call it solar thermal or concentrated solar power. So it's basically the same idea. You're taking, instead of having these panels create electricity directly, These solar panels are all focused at the sun. They focus, they're basically mirrors, and they bounce off the light to a place at the top there of that tower, captures the light. I think it's around 1400 degrees, which means you have a lot of hot water, which can be used for steam to create electricity. So this seems like a pretty great technology. One of the best things about solar thermal is that because you're creating hot water instead of electricity directly, you can actually store this. So this can't be stored forever, but you can store it for a few days. So if you make a lot of hot water and then you have a rain storm come through here and it shuts this down for a couple of days or reduces its effectiveness significantly for a few days, because you have all this stored hot water, they actually store it in molten salt. So the heat is actually stored in a salt vat rather than water, but you can store it. So that has one advantage over the traditional type of solar. But, so let's talk about what else is good about this. I guess pretty much the same thing as we talked about before. Anywhere where there's sun, it's very clean, reasonably inexpensive. I mean, I think over a lifetime, this is probably competitive with coal or natural gas, probably. We've just got a few of these plants that have come on. And heat can be stored for a few days. So one problem is intermittency that we talked about, reliability. It's more reliable than the other type of solar because you can't store it for a few days, but it still has intermittency issues. But you still have low capacity factors, still ranging in the 15 to 25% range. And so this is that's one problem. But another problem that probably you don't think of is these plants use a lot of water. And I don't know if you noticed where this plant is, but it's out in the Mojave Desert, and there's not a lot of water. And then using a lot of water, there's already a lot of competition for water resources out here with farmers and ranchers and municipalities, so that's a problem. But there's a new emerging problem that's even worse, and that is it's killing a lot of birds. I'm going to explain this. What happens when you go out on your porch, not so much here in Colorado, we don't have that many bugs. You go out on your porch and you turn on your porch light, what does it attract? Especially if you're living in Texas or Oklahoma or someplace, it attracts a lot of bugs. And then what do the bugs attract? Birds and bats. Birds and bats love bugs, so they see this. And so this was never considered when they built this solar plant out in the Mojave. And I'm trying to find my statistics here, but I think I remember them. All of a sudden, these birds were flying, looking for bugs, and the bugs are attracted to the light, and the birds come over here, and all these mirrors are reflecting to 1400 degrees, and basically the birds' feathers implode. They basically light a fire, and the birds then plummet to their death and land on the ground. And the industry itself has a name for this. They call them streamers because the birds are still alive, and as they're falling, they can't sustain their weight because their feathers are on fire. And so these are not my statistics, but the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has interjected itself into this. And they've done a review of this plant in the Mojave Desert. And I'm not saying that they know because it was a short, you know, it was just a period of a few weeks that they studied this. But based on what they'd seen in a few weeks, they projected that this site would kill about 28,000 birds a year. So that's not a lot if you think about it on the big scale, but it sounds a little onerous and it's a little bit of a black eye for the solar industry. So we'll see where this goes, how much the streamers, hate to be callous, but that's actually what they're called, how much the streamers affect the development of this in the future. Okay, any question about any of these? Is anybody still awake? Another problem, so we're moving on beyond just the generation of the electricity from renewable energy. Think about where we are generating our renewable energy. Wind, Wyoming, North Dakota, Oklahoma. We've got all these places where it's very windy, where you've got wind farms. Where is the electricity needed? LA, Chicago, New York. So one big problem, it's the same with solar. I mean, solar arrays are most effective out in the desert, but there's not people out in the desert. So one of the biggest issues facing us going forward the next 20 years is how do we, even if we can find ways to safely and economically and effectively create renewable energy, whether wind, solar PV, or solar thermal. How do we get all this electricity to market? Right now, we're already strained on how we get the electricity out. You guys, or a lot of you guys, probably know how difficult it is to build pipelines long distances or other types of utilities long distance. And if you're going to build, a wind farm in Wyoming and you're going to try and take that electricity to San Francisco, think about all of the state agencies, the federal agencies, the local municipalities, not to mention the private landowners that you're going to have to deal with. And so we can start sit here and build all these renewable resources. If we can, build them effectively, cost effectively, in places where it works, we still have a big problem with transmission. And so going forward, I just tell you this, just so you can think about it. Obviously, nobody wants this in their backyard. There's a lot of environmentalists. I noticed in the East Coast last week in New York that there were some environmentalists that were protesting against a new power line coming through, you know, southern New York to New York City. And, you know, New York City needs the electricity, and yet you've got environmental groups that are standing up. So, you know, the solution there is use less energy, I guess. But the problem is transmission concerns going forward are going to be a huge issue. And the truth is our transmission system is basically the same today as it's been for 100 years. It's old, it's old-fashioned, it hasn't been upgraded, and there's a lot of capital needed to be to bring the transmission system in up to speed. Okay, what do we know about electric vehicles? Anybody who drive one? Come on.
I've driven one.
You have driven one. You don't own one.
Yeah.
Okay. So why do we want electric vehicles? Well, what is the whole big deal? What's the big deal about electric vehicles? I mean, we hear so much about it, and Betsy sent me this article today saying the change is coming, and in 10 years, everybody's going to be driving EVs. Well, let me tell you why it's been such a big hot button issue, because I think that it has been, but a lot of people don't understand it. As we know, we talked about, we have these issues with power plants. We're trying to, we have all these peak power plants that we use that are not used, but just a few hours a day or a few days a week or a few days a month. And we got a lot of capital invested in them. So that's one thing. It would be better if we could store energy and not have all this backup capacity, because they're not it's not efficient use of capital, but we have to because of reliability issues. So we have all these plants. So the idea about 25 years ago was, if we could create a fleet of electric vehicles, and if we could get everyone to drive an electric vehicle, and we could generate clean electricity to charge those electric vehicles, we could kill two birds with one stone. We could get rid of gasoline, because we have electric vehicles that are being charged with clean electricity. And the second part of it is everybody drives this electric vehicle and they charge it at night when electricity's cheap. And then it's available for the grid later on when we need that peak power. So let me just give you a scenario. Everybody here drives an electric vehicle, and we go home at night. Now, I told you one of the things that's coming down the line is real-time pricing, which means that electricity is going to be cheaper at night than it is during the day, because of the day we have higher demand and we have to pay for those expensive peak power plants. So expensive electricity in the day, cheap power at night. So now we're all going to drive electric cars. We're going to go home, we're going to watch the news, we're going to plug in our car, and all night when electricity is 3 cents a kilowatt hour, we're going to charge the cars for cheap. And then we're going to drive them to our designated parking spot over at Encana and plug in our car to its regular spot. And that the XL Energy will actually identify your car. They'll know your car. Wherever it's plugged in, they'll know that's your car. And at 2 o'clock, when it starts to get hot, XL doesn't have enough electricity because they don't have peak power plants anymore, because we've gotten rid of peak power plants. Instead, they're going to send out a signal to all the cars in Denver, and it says, we need more electricity because the electricity demand's up, and we want to know who wants to sell electricity back to the grid for the next 15 minutes at 30 cents a kilowatt hour. So you've charged it overnight at 3 cents, and you're going to sell it back to the grid. Now, Allison says no. She programs her car before she gets in the car and says, no, I don't want to sell any electricity today because I'm going to the airport afterwards and I need the charge to get to the airport. But Stacy says, I don't have anything going on. I'm just going straight home. I just need enough energy to get back home. And so she programs her car to sell electricity to the grid. Now at 2:30, it gets above 100. And now we need more electricity. Now Eric over here, he at 2 o'clock, he says, I'm not selling for 30 cents. I'm holding out. And he programs his car not to sell any electricity to XL until it gets to 50 cents. But at 2:30 in the afternoon, it's so hot and there's no other place to go, his car automatically starts downloading electricity into the grid. This happens millions and millions of times over the course of a day. Then it's good for you. You can make money by managing your electric load on your car. We have clean electricity. We don't have to have gasoline anymore. We don't have to have these power plants. So what's the problem? Is there a problem with all this?
You keep saying clean electricity.
Okay, well, that's one problem. So we're gonna get to that in a second. Anybody have range anxiety? Well, that's the term we use in the EV market for people who are worried about their electric cars not getting where they want to go. And this is a real problem because most of us do more driving than we could do on an electric car. In Boulder, where I work, they have a dealership there, which is part of your purchase price package. When you buy your car, you know, instead of getting a certain number of free oil changes or reduced price oil changes, you get a certain amount of tows per year. You get a certain amount of tows with your car because they know that you're going. As a matter of fact, I interviewed a guy yesterday. I'm so involved with these EVs. Anytime I see anyone driving one, I interview them, and I have a little chart that I've been keeping. And I ran into a guy yesterday at Home Depot, and I asked him, and he says, yeah, I drive it here. But only here in town, because if I ever got on the highway, I've got range anxiety. He says, yeah, I just saw a leaf on the side of the Boulder Turnpike yesterday when I was coming home from Denver. So this is one big issue. The amount of time to recharge. A lot of people think they're going to recharge these cars. You know, if they're going to go to the store, I'll just plug it in at the REI where they've got a charging station. The problem is that it really takes about 4 to 6 hours to recharge these cars. Now, they're starting to put in these charging stations that are high-speed recharging, but the problem is that damages the batteries. So you can get a high-speed charge, but then you're going to have to replace the car battery in 2 or 3 years because you're always constantly fast charging it, and that battery might cost you $10,000 or $12,000 to replace. So, lack of infrastructure to recharge. Now in California, and back in Allison's neck of the woods, they're putting in lots of recharging stations, which is all fine, except that who is paying for them? All the people who don't have electric vehicles, because what happens is the utility puts in these charging stations at $30,000 a pop, and they're putting them all over San Francisco and Sacramento, and rarely do you see a car parked in any of them, but they're saying, well, build them and they will come. And then who pays for it? Well, all that cost goes into the rate base, and all the rate base then gets passed on to all the customers. And now there's sort of an uprising in California because all these customers are paying for charging stations that aren't being used or are being used by people who aren't paying for them. Performance is another issue because I know that the Leaf, for instance, they now proudly say that our car will go 100 miles on a charge. But that's like the solar panels. It's only under the absolute optimum circumstances. If the car is driving on a flat ground with no hills and no sunshine and there's no air conditioning and no radio on, and it's the right temperature outside, it can go 100 miles. But the reality is that's never the case. If it's above 70 degrees, the battery actually has to cool itself. So it uses energy to cool itself to keep it at the right operating temperature. If it's too cold, the battery uses its own energy to heat itself so that it's at the right temperature to go. And then if you want to turn on the air conditioning or you want to turn on the radio, it's going to significantly reduce the range. So there are some issues with the EV. But Stacy appropriately acknowledged the biggest issue, and that is clean energy. And so For years, people have been speculating that if you use electricity to charge a car, I mean, I think a lot of people charge, get an electric car and think, I'm good to go, I'm clean. Even the Leaf says zero emissions. So you think you buy the car, you have zero emissions. But where is the car being charged? Well, where do you think it's being charged? In the garage at home? And yeah, where's your electricity coming from? Well, 2/3 of it is coal. So, I fast forward to a study that came out last year, and I'd like to point out it was done by three highly regarded scholars at the University of Minnesota. They did this report over the course of several years, and then they submitted this report to NREL here in Golden, and Golden reviewed it and gave it their gold star and said this report is absolutely on point. And I'm not going to go into all the finer points, but basically, if you operate an electric vehicle and it's charged with renewable energy, that is the best possible case. If you have an electric vehicle and you charge it with renewable, then you've got clean electricity, you're not having gasoline, no fumes, no nothing, you're good to go. But if you charge an electric vehicle with coal, it's worse than almost anything. It's worse than a gasoline engine, it's worse than a gasoline hybrid, it's worse than diesel, it's worse than ethanol even. So the reality is, so here's basically the grid average. So that's the United States, that 39% coal. So on average in the United States, we use 39% coal. So that means using the grid average of the United States, we're still almost twice as dirty as a gasoline engine. And if you look at this compared to Colorado, which uses 60% coal, driving an electric vehicle in Denver or in Boulder in Colorado is probably 4 or 5 times dirtier than driving a gasoline engine car. Now, how many people do that? How many people do you think that are driving these cars know that? That's So I didn't plant you in the audience, but a good question. So I have a cousin who is a real environmentalist on the East Coast, and so I sent this report to him, and I said, aha, what do you think about this? And he writes me back this email, and he literally said, you dumb shit. Do you think anyone would buy an EV and not use renewable energy to charge it? And so I started thinking to myself, wow, maybe I'm in the wrong, maybe my whole perspective is all skewed. Maybe I'm in over here, and I never occurred to me that could be the case. And so I started doing research, and I contacted NREL, I contacted XL Energy. Basically, I looked everywhere for research on this subject, and XL told me that there's not enough consumers, that there is no research on this. So I carry around in my briefcase and in my car, a little form. And so anytime I see one of these, I see a lot of them in Boulder. Anytime I see one of these, I actually, if I can, I stop them. I ask them if they have time to fill out this form. I hand them the form to either fill out and mail back to me with a self-addressed stamped envelope, or they do the thing right here. So I've been doing my own research on this. Now, I'm not saying it's scientific, but I've been doing this for 1.5 years now. And much to the chagrin of my cousin, I have yet to find a single person who is charging their car with renewable energy. Not one. Not one. Not just one oddball. I talked to one guy last year who said that he bought his car thinking that he was going to use the solar cells on his house to charge the car. So he had at least the right idea and the right perspective, and his heart was in the right place. But he said, you know, after I spent the $30,000 on that 100-mile car, I realized that I'm not home during the day when the sun is shining. I'm at work. And he said, then I started thinking, well, I felt obligated to stay home on the weekend so I could charge it on Saturday and Sunday, but then I couldn't run my errands or do anything. So anyway, the whole point is that these electric vehicles may be really good if we can get a clean form of energy to charge them. But it's ludicrous right now to be driving an EV. Now, if you want to drive an EV, most of the people that I interview, they have no idea about this. And most of them are so proud that they're doing the right thing. They're all doing it because they think they're doing the right thing. And I really blame the dealerships and everyone else for promoting these things and pushing these things, because they're making money off of it, full well knowing. In fact, one of the other benefits you get at the Boulder Nissan is you can charge free at their charging station anytime. So if you want to go to Whole Foods or go over to 28th Street Mall, you can park over there and charge while you do your shopping and come back. The problem is they don't use renewable energy either. They just scoff at it. I mean, that would make more sense if you offered something like that. So I don't blame these people, but the problem is that nobody knows this. If you want to drive an EV and you want to do it because you're trying to promote the technology and you're trying to push the envelope and say this is where we should be going, that's one thing. But to drive it thinking you're doing something good and you're actually doing something much worse is really a tragedy. So that's where we are on EVs. Any questions about that? Okay, we're doing good. I'm hurrying through. We're going to be done early. Smart grid. Who has heard of smart grid? Who's heard the term smart grid? Okay, what does smart grid mean? Anybody? You raised your hand.
I said I've heard of it.
Okay, who here would like to define smart grid? Allison? Grant.
I thought the smart grid was kind of where every different part of the grid can communicate to itself and help shift and move energy around.
Okay. There are so many components to smart grid. There is no definition, so-called definition of smart grid. It's different everywhere, different to every person. But let's talk about a little bit about Grant's part is one component of that. Because we talk about how our grid is basically no better technologically now than it was in 1882 when they built the first power lines from the power plant in Lower Manhattan over to, you know, wherever it was going. It's the same technology. And so it's dumb. We call it dumb technology because let's say that you have a transformer that gets hit by lightning in your neighborhood and you lose electricity. How does the electric company know to come and fix it?
Everyone calls,
that's exactly right. They don't know. There's no two-way communication. There's nothing on that power pole that sends a signal down the line back to this, emergency relief. It's dumb. So this is how it happens now. You call the power company, they don't know the problem. So then they dispatch some guy on double time, overtime, gets in his truck, drives out to your neighborhood, is going up and down the streets trying to figure out where the problem is. He finally sees the tree that's come down the power line, or sees the transformer is blown up, whatever it is, then he doesn't have what he needs to fix it. Then he has to go back to the shop or call somebody else to come out. So, I mean, this is really dumb. So the first concept of smart grid, as Grant said, is to upgrade the electric system so that the system communicates with itself, and so that the people back in the 17th floor of the XL building, when that happens, they know what happened. They know what went out. They know who to dispatch. They know what equipment to send out. But that's only just a small part of it. Because the other issue is that if we're going to have, if we want to manage our load, our demand, and manage our peak time and reduce the number of peak power plants we have to better manage what's going on at the house. And so where things are going, and Boulder was one of the first test sites for this nationwide. I think there were two national test sites. I think Raleigh, North Carolina, and Boulder were the first two sites selected for this. But this is, I'm just going to give you a vision of where we might be in 20 years. Every house will have a smart meter on it, and we'll have the smart power lines so that communicate back and forth from spot to spot. In your house, your refrigerator will have a chip in it. Actually, some of the refrigerators that are manufactured right now already have the smart chip in it. And you can program your refrigerator to talk to XL Energy. You can program your hot tub. You can program your air conditioner. You can program your washer and dryer. And what I mean communicate with them is we're going to move to real-time pricing. So instead of having your price at 11 cents a kilowatt hour every hour of the day, XL is going to start charging you 3 cents at night, 7 cents in the morning, in the afternoon it might be 46 cents if it's a really hot day. It's going to be real time based on what their real cost is. And having done that, then you're going to be able to manipulate your appliances to be responsive to those price demands, those price signals. So they send out a price signal, and you may program your dishwasher and say, I'm not running the dishwasher unless the price of electricity is under 5 cents, which is more likely going to be at night. So you load the dishwasher, hit the button, and then it says, you know, waits until the price goes to 5 cents. Maybe that night it never goes to 5 cents, so maybe the dishwasher doesn't run. Or you could do the same thing with your washer and dryer. Another way they're going to manage demand, which they're already doing right now, is giving Xcel the right to manage your refrigerator and to manage your air conditioner. So a lot of people already have this. You can pay Xcel Energy. I think Xcel gives you like a 10% discount annually on your bill if you will give them the right to take over your air conditioner for 15 minutes an hour during the summer. Something like that. I don't know the exact details. So what that basically does is I'm reducing my energy costs because I have to pay 10% less, but I'm giving up some control and letting them, when they need electricity, they can do, when you got peak power issue in the middle of the day, you got two issues. Buy more power from Wyoming at a very expensive price or reduce demand. And so you can program your air conditioner to be responsive to price. You might program your air conditioner and say, I really don't want it to go down, but if the price really gets high, I might be willing to sacrifice, that sort of thing. And then we get back to the issue of the cars. You're going to recharge your car in the middle of the night. Then you're going to decide how you're going to use that energy. You may keep it for yourself. You may sell it to Xcel. There may be other operators. You may be able to sell it to your own company. Maybe you charge your electricity at night for 3 cents. You work for Google, and they have a charging station during the day when they're running their computers. Maybe they run their computers off of your car, and you charge Google for the right to do that. So that's where we see smart grid going. Power is information. I know that in Boulder, I was told that when they put smart meters on all these houses, that just having the information engages the customer. On average, the average bill for a customer goes down 8% just having the smart meter, because they're more engaged. They see on their phone dings them and says, oh, your power is up this afternoon or whatever, or just being conscious about it, or thinking about turning out lights when they might normally not be. So just having the smart meter alone might affect a 10% reduction overall in electricity use. And then it would give you tools to reduce it beyond that. And I think that's going to wrap it up. I'm going to point out that the organization that I run, apart from my day job, is this Energy Press C. Our organization is entirely devoted to energy education. There's no other mission. There's no advocacy. We don't accept advertising from anybody for any reason, because we want to be free to just talk about the facts and not be beholden to anybody. If you're interested, you can follow us on Twitter. I usually try and tweet at least once a day something interesting about energy. You can follow on LinkedIn. That's a good place if you're just interested in more information about energy beyond our normal oil and gas world. Go to LinkedIn, go to Energy Pressy and follow, and then you will have access to lots of information articles. So, anybody have any questions? It's not often that I get done early, but I'm glad to think that I did. Nobody?
Yeah, I've got one.
Okay, thanks.
So what's your prediction on the pricing right now, like both natural gas and?
Well, natural gas, I saw a prediction 2 years ago from IHS that said they don't see a real inflation-adjusted increase in gas for at least 30 years. And I'm not sure that that's incorrect. It might be. but we have so much gas, and every time we see a price uptick, you know, in the old days when we would go on these cycles and we'd get in a down cycle, and then everybody would run out and find some gas, and then the gas price would go down because the volume's up, and then all of a sudden people stop drilling, and then it just goes down again. But now, anytime there's a spike in the gas price, you've got so much, you basically have a whole nation of gas in storage. The Haynesville Shale, the Marcellus, You know, most of these places, you've got one well drilled on a section where you might drill another 7 to 16 wells. And so every time the prices creep up, you're going to have an almost instantaneous, within a few months, you have the ability to match that price increase with increased production. And so I'm not predicting that, but I don't think that that's an unrealistic thought to think that real inflation adjusted prices for natural gas might not increase for quite a while. Oil's a little bit different because it's more of a world commodity. And I think that one of the advantages of natural gas is if we can find more places to burn it instead of coal, and maybe we can export it. But the world is awash in gas. Australia has so much gas available. And I'm not optimistic that we're gonna see a huge increase in natural gas prices. Oil's a little different, but I see a lot of the same thing happening. Basically, the shale oil market here, we're in the same place with shale oil as we were in natural gas. Whenever the price spikes, we can go out and drill shale wells in the Niobrara or in the Wolf Camp or wherever we want to. And so I think it'll be less pronounced, but I think that it's gonna be hard to get it back, you know, to a really high level, to be honest. And Grant has to.
Oh, just kind of on that same note, do you have any idea, Doug, what the cost is to convert a coal-fired power plant to a nat gas? What
the
cost would be?
I don't know.
I'm just curious. So I felt like kind of one of the underlying messages today was natural gas is probably
the best
option.
Yeah, I'm not here to promote natural gas, but I think that's a good.
So I can just give you an example of NiSource, which is based out of Indiana. We just converted two, and it was about $500 million each.
Okay.
How big a plant? You know that?
One was fairly large. It was right on the Ohio bank there, so they're large. I mean, they're about $500 million.
Okay.
Sir. Mr. Aspinall.
You've kind of blown my mind about the myth of reduction of a carbon footprint on driving these electric vehicles. And I think that that's kind of the predominant myth of that if you get it, you reduce your carbon footprint. Is there any value in these early adopters as far as setting the groundwork for eventually setting up the infrastructure of having these mobile batteries that can communicate back and forth?
I think that's the only justification at this point.
Would it be more valuable to wait until we have the renewable kind of infrastructure and better batteries until we have a bit more adoption of EVs?
You know, the answer to that is depends on your perspective. You know, some people who are so pro renewable would say it's worth anything to get the early adoption going on building infrastructure. And so I can't argue, I can say they can make a reasonable argument for that. And then I think the people who say this is ridiculous that we're driving cars that are making 3, 4, 5 times as much pollution right now. And so I personally think maybe there's a middle ground. I think maybe we should just tap the brakes a little bit and slow down. And I think the first priority should be, let's find a way to make clean electricity. And then as we start to see that we can make meaningful amounts of clean electricity, then let's push the gas forward and try and push the electric vehicles. But I'm not even sure. I mean, this article that Betsy sent me said 10 years from now, electric vehicles are king. But not everybody agrees with that. You know, Toyota just got out of the EV market altogether. They just decided this was never going to be adopted because of the range anxiety, because of the ability to do clean electricity. Toyota, largest car maker in the world, doesn't even have an electric vehicle. They've decided they're going fuel cell. They think it's going to be better for us to do hydrogen fuel cells than it is electricity. So I don't think the final decision has been made. We haven't seen the song hasn't been sung. What else? Stacy?
You talk about energy being so low cost at night, but it sounds like we're all going to go home and we're all going to be doing everything at night.
Well, it'll help out though, because what happens is we've got excess of energy at night, and so yes, it will. It'll bring the prices up because we'll push demand there, but it'll pull prices down during the day because we won't have as much peak power. So what it does is it just evens it out. But if you're smart and you can manage to play the game, you can manage it to your advantage. And those who don't, you know, won't be able to leverage the advantage. So, but yes, prices naturally will go up at night because you'll have more demand as you push demand that way, which is what we want to do. We want to push demand tonight, to nighttime. All right, well, thanks for your time. I hope you learned something. I'm going to hang around, answer questions, talk or meet with anybody who wants to, but anybody needs to get back to work, get back to work.